kids here this morning? Raise your hand if you're a kid. If you're a kid here this morning, raise your hand. Do you love pictures? If there's no pictures in class, some parents, some kids get really bored, right? And so you're just like, oh, I'm bored, so I'm gonna draw or write or whatever. And be distracted, right? So you can put your hands down now. So basically, I'm gonna sign this lesson and I'm gonna be really animated when I do it. So hopefully, everyone can understand. And if you don't understand, go ahead and ask your parents. That's totally fine, all right? What does that mean? It's totally fine to go ahead and ask your parents when you don't understand something that I'm talking about. It's totally fine. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and read our scripture this morning. 1 Samuel 3, verses 1 and 2. Now the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no widespread revelation. And it came to pass that in time, while Eli was lying down in his place, his eyes began to grow so dim that he could not see. So I've been teaching on 1 Samuel over the past several weeks, and the title of my message this morning is Did Not Know the Lord Yahweh, and we're noticing that there is a continual theme that's actually reoccurring in chapters 2 and 3, and it's this concept of not knowing the Lord Yahweh. So 2 weeks ago, I just want to do a quick review of what we talked about. God called Eli, and he sent a prophet to him to warn him of a specific judgment that was coming. And Eli, the high priest of God, was given this warning that he did not follow God's law, he did not do what God said, and here was the command. There was going to be a strict punishment that was informed to him by a prophet. This was a reprimand from God. Go ahead and read that. And so that's what happened 2 weeks ago. So now for the title of my message, Did Not Know the Lord Yahweh. So Eli, the priest, was in charge of Samuel, and the two of them worked in a specific place, and that place was the tabernacle. They worked together each and every day, doing the work of the tabernacle. Now Eli's sons were wicked men. They were involved in horrible sin. They were stealing from God. They were stealing raw meat and eating the meat with the fat. They also were involved in sexual sin with different women. So Eli's sons were very in a lot of trouble from God. And it says that Eli's sons did not know the Lord Yahweh. But Eli was a servant of the tabernacle. They were serving God, but they did not know him. Samuel, the young boy, Hannah had given him up to the service of the Lord and given him to Eli the priest. God had given her what she had asked. She had had a child, and she presented him before the Lord. And Samuel was a small child, and he entered into the tabernacle. And he obeyed and did what Eli commanded him. He did the different duties of the tabernacle. When Eli told him to clean, he would clean. He would do the different jobs, the different responsibilities. Like, for example, children, they need to obey their parents and do what their parents tell them to do. Also, the people in church, we need to serve when God calls us to do that. So you'll notice the contrast here between disobedience and obedience that's going on inside of the tabernacle. Eli and his sons, they're doing work before God, but they have had no personal interaction with God. They're disobeying God, and Samuel is obeying God. so as I consider this, I think about how, you know, a tabernacle is kind of similar to a church. In the past, they had a tabernacle, and now we have a church. Oftentimes, people are very excited about going to church and ministering in church and serving in church. But it's rare to see people who are in fellowship with God. And there are oftentimes people who go to church, they serve in the church, they're very motivated to do all these things. But they do not have personal knowledge, and God has not revealed himself to them. But they do all these different things. They advertise, they work, they get people together. You know, whether they're hearing or deaf, but they come to church and they fellowship and they interact with individuals. And it looks like they're obeying. But there are some people who go to church and they do these lists, this list of things. They sign well, they social, they interact. But when they go, but they're lonely outside and they're in disobedience and they interact and they do things. They are not obeying God in their hearts. And they want pleasure. There are people who love pleasure and they don't love God. They want pleasure, they want fun, they want good times. And they think, oh, you know, there's good people at church, so I'm going to go there and be around those people and learn. I'm going to learn about God later. But they're not really obeying God in the first place. Their hearts are in disobedience and rebellion against God. So now we're going to take a look at Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 and 10. Eli's sons, we're not following God. And Eli also, he was not following God. We consider, you know, history, and we look all throughout the Old Testament, and God chooses different priests. And there is only one perfect high priest, through he, a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And being perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him, called by God as high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Jesus Christ is the only one who is the perfect high priest. Eli and his sons, they were deceitful. They offered sacrifices. They did all these things, but they were in their hearts, they had sin. They were stealing, and they were not following God's law perfectly. Only Jesus Christ is the perfect high priest. Back to our verses in Samuel. Eli received a message. He wasn't commanded of God constantly, and he wasn't telling people all the time. There were other priests that would be informed, and God would speak directly to them, and they would speak directly to the people. But at this time, there was no direct revelation from God. Eli wasn't communicated directly by God. Or there was very little communication at this time in history. So in chapter 2, God sent a prophet to him to tell him that you've ignored God, you've disregarded God's commands, and God is going to cut you off. Him and his sons, they had become fat off the meat that was supposed to be God's. And Eli became blind during this time. You know, he was supposed to do different duties, offering sacrifices. He wasn't a good, strong leader. He became a terrible leader. And there was a decline. He was blind. He couldn't do his job. So he became limited in his ability. And instead, as Eli became blind, Samuel began to serve more before the Lord and serve in the tabernacle and do the different duties that were required. It came to pass when Eli was lying down in his place, when his eyes could not see, that before the lamp of God went out of the tabernacle of the Lord Yahweh, where the ark of the Lord was, while Samuel was lying down. So Samuel would do different things inside the tabernacle, and Eli was sleeping. Eli could not see anymore, and he couldn't do anything. He couldn't really do his duties, and so Samuel took the responsibility. He slept near the Ark of the Covenant, that special place, and sleep nearby it. So this right here is a picture of Samuel asleep. So he's sleeping near the tabernacle. And he hears Samuel, Samuel, his name being called. And he wakes up. And so he gets up and he goes out to check on Eli, the high priest, because this is his boss. And so he says, "You called for me." And Eli wakes up and says, "No, I didn't call you. Go to bed, go to bed. So once again, Samuel lies in bed and hears Samuel, his name being called once again. So he thinks, well, it must be Eli. So he goes in, and again, he says, "You called for me, Eli. Here I am. What do you want me to do?" And Eli says, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed." So again, Samuel is sleeping, and now this third time, he's laying in bed, and he hears his name being called, so he goes to Eli and says, "What do you want? I'm here. I've heard you. You called me." And finally, Eli perceives what's going on. He realizes, for so long, there's been no revelation of God, no direct revelation. But he realizes that in this case, there has been direct revelation. So Eli knew the Lord, knew Yahweh. His sons didn't. It took several times for Eli to realize that God was speaking to Samuel. So Eli served before the Lord. He did all of these things for God. But he did not have a relationship with God. So Eli realized that God wasn't communicating with him and his family members. And God looked at their sin and their rebellion against him. And he decided not to use Eli and his family. Eli became blind. He couldn't really do the job of the tabernacle, and instead Samuel was now taking up this leadership role, and he was involved as if he was involved in like the church. God was now instead going to use Samuel. God was rejecting Eli and his family, just as the prophet Eli starts to realize, oh, God is speaking to Samuel. In chapter 2, a prophet said that his family and his family would be cut off. Would you guys like to tell your sin to everyone? Yes, I've done this sin, I've done this sin, I've done that sin. No, we conceal our sin. We don't like to tell anyone about it. Eli considers how God has not called him and not spoken to him, but he realizes, oh, God is calling Samuel. So, finally, this third time, Eli tells Samuel to say, speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth. And Samuel says, okay, God's calling me, okay? So he goes back to sleep, and God calls Samuel, Samuel, 2 times. We'll take a look at the response. Verse 10. Now, the Lord Yahweh came and stood and called as another time, Samuel, Samuel.
Yeah.
And Samuel answered, speak, for your servant hears. Samuel. Will do something in Israel at which both ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. And in that day I will perform against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knows, because his sons made themselves vile. And he did not restrain them. And verse 14 says, and therefore I have sworn to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be atoned by sacrifice offering forever. Well, this is what God said to Samuel, gave him faith. He said, Eli, your family, your wickedness will not be forgiven. You are cut off, and that's it. Why did he do this? Let's look at the next verse. Because Eli looked at his son's sin. No more remission of sins for them. They were cut off.
Yeah.
So the Lord told these things to Samuel. And he was maybe 12 to 15 years old, receiving this message from the Lord. And Samuel thought it over. God was speaking directly to him. And he was telling him about this judgment. Now, Eli knew God's sovereignty. He knew. And Samuel didn't. They had different perspectives. So, overnight, Eli opened the tabernacle. And Samuel was curious. Tell me, what's going on? What's happening? What happened last night? Did God speak? What did he do? Eli was asking Samuel, what did the Lord say? And Samuel felt, how could I tell Eli what God told me, that he would punish him? How would you feel if you had to say something like that? He didn't want to tell Eli. Eli was his mentor. He was under him as a servant. He was obeying him and learning from him. He loved Eli. And now God had given him this judgment. It looked like something against Eli, this judgment, that Samuel couldn't figure out how to tell him. He was afraid. He was afraid. This was a challenge. Eli said, "Please tell me. I have to know exactly everything the Lord spoke to you." And I'll just summarize this. Eli said, "I must know everything the Lord spoke to you. Do not hide anything from me. Not one piece of information." And Samuel told him everything. Nothing hidden. He gave him a blunt, direct message about the judgment on Eli. And Eli looked back to the warning the prophet had given him, and he knew. He couldn't hold it back anymore. And it showed God's sovereignty. The judgment was impossible to escape from. God's judgment was certain. The prophet had warned him first. Eli had left it alone. But God was committed to carrying out this judgment. It would happen. Now God called Samuel, and he became the prophet to share this information with Eli, this other warning. And now Eli would no longer be used, but Samuel would. Eli should have recognized the sinning of his sons and put an end to it. He should not have tolerated it. You see Christians in the church that hide their sin, that cover their sin. We've got to stop it. Sit down with whoever's sinning and discipline them in love and tell them to repent. But with Eli, he was benefiting from it. He profited from his son's sin. He got to eat all of that meat, the meat that his sons were stealing. He was able to eat it and delight in that meat. There was no burned meat from the offering. It was fresh and raw. It was stolen from the offering. He accepted it. It tasted good to him. That was his weakness. Just like our weaknesses might be today. So the Lord Yahweh told him about this punishment, and that his sins would no longer be forgiven, he would be completely cut off. And God turned his attention, because Eli had sinned, the previous leader, Eli, would no more lead, and God turned his attention to Samuel. And Samuel became the most powerful prophet, preaching God's word, warning of judgment. Scripture says Samuel grew, and the Lord Yahweh was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. This is interesting. That means everything that God spoke happened. It certainly happened. All of it. Just like saying, "You've sinned and you'll die." Well, tomorrow, he died. The next day, that happened. Destruction will happen, and it happened. Invaders from another country will come in and invade, and it will happen. God's word is sure. There's power behind his word. And the Jews of Israel in the north and in the south turned to Samuel. From Dan to Beersheba, the north to the south, they knew that Samuel had been established as a prophet of the Lord. Then the Lord Yahweh appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord Yahweh revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord Yahweh. And Eli diminished. He'd been punished, and God was using Samuel. And Samuel became a great prophet, and God spoke his words to Samuel. he was a 12, 15-year-old kid who became this amazingly disciplined man of the Lord. Amazing. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13 says, "And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account." What does that mean? That means we don't run and hide. God sees us. Like if I were to hide behind this podium, God would see through it. He sees through you. Like x-ray vision. You get an x-ray. It's just like God's sight. He can see through anything. You try to hide, but it's like you're open and naked. God can see you. He's everywhere. It's impossible to hide from the Lord. You have to give an account. You can't escape him. You'll lose. You'll be beaten by the Lord. You cannot hide from him. Eli had to give an account. And he hid. He was warned. The prophet came to him and he still hid. He left it alone. He continued in his wickedness. And Samuel gave him that second warning. How depressing. Wow, this is a sad message. Can sin be forgiven? Not Eli's. He was cut off. His family was cut off. He couldn't offer a sacrifice. He couldn't say sorry. The Lord cut Eli and his family off. He couldn't say, "Sorry, I've sinned. I'll change, I'll repent, I'll give you more sacrifices." No, the Lord cut him off forever. In the New Testament, is it the same as the Old Testament? You'll be cut off and punished forever? You'll be judged and that's it? The New Testament tells us if we've committed an offense, we turn to God. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we've committed iniquity, we turn towards the Lord and he's faithful to forgive us our sins. You compare that to Eli's situation. Stealing food, you think that's no big deal. He didn't punish his sons and he let it go. But even worse sins today, God forgives. Eli was reprimanded once and that was it. But wow, thank you to our sovereign God who forgives us our sins by his grace. Samuel's warning of that sin, he saw what had happened in that tabernacle. And in our lives, as we come before for the Lord's Supper, you might think, "Oh, this is no big deal. Our sins, no big deal. I'll go ahead and drink the wine and eat the bread anyway. I don't want people to look at me if I didn't take it. That means I've sinned. So you hide your sin. It's better to repent. Tell the Lord I'm sorry. He is faithful to forgive us all of our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Please stand. The family that prays together, praying together is important. Eli sinned and turned from God, and his prayer life diminished. And you saw what happened with his two sons. They were stealing. That meant Eli's family, do you think they prayed together? Likely not. It's important that we pray as a family. We keep praying together. It's the father's responsibility to pray with the children. Children ask their parents to pray with them. It goes two ways. Children pray, parents pray. Heavenly Father, bless us this morning as we look into your word. Please help the Holy Spirit to move our hearts as we consider our lives and the challenges we face, the warnings of our sin, that we would not hide our sins, but that we would turn to you. you would have a repentful heart.